नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ये यथा मां प्रपद्यन्ते तांस्तथैव भजाम्यहम् मम वर्तमानुवर्तन्ते मनुष्याः पार्थ सर्वशः Translation. As all surrender unto me, I reward them accordingly. Everyone follows my path in all respects, O son of Prutha. Hare Krishna. So we welcome everyone for studying Bhagavad Gita. So last time we studied position of Krishna. And today we are going to study action based on that transcendental knowledge. So verses 11 to 22. No, no. I want you to speak first and then I'll continue. So we invite the Agarwal family to come forward and present.
Hare Krishna. So, yeah, last time Chandra Mataji has already set a very high standard for these presentations. So, she explained lots of details of each shloka. So, in contrast, I'm just jotting down few points and just I've read through them because I don't remember most of them. And whichever I miss, Prabhuji will anyway explain. So, okay, so this chapter, Transcendental Knowledge, from shloka 1 to 10, it is explained that how this transcendental knowledge has come to us through systematic disciplic succession. And Krishna has also explained what was his purpose of descendance periodically into this world. And now this section 4.11 to 24, as I understood, it covers three points basically. It's about application of that transcendental knowledge. And also there is an introduction about the Varnashram system. And where, how one can continue during his prescribed duties and fulfill their material desire and also simultaneously progress towards liberation. And the third point is how to perform activities on the transcendental plane. So how one can perform actions without getting entangled or attached into it. So first shloka starts with ye yathamam prabadante. So here Krishna explains that how he reciprocates to Jivatma according to one's degree of surrender unto him. In the purport, Prabhupada explains that there are three ways absolute truth can be realized. Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagwan. So Krishna fulfills the desires of each and every person according to which the level where they desire him. So for example, if a person believes in Brahman, so he can merge into Brahma Jyoti. So in the next shloka, Krishna explains that why unintelligent people worship demigods and what is the results of such activities. So, Prabhupada explains that people are mad after temporary things and they want the results quickly. So, they worship demigods, but Krishna tries to satisfy everyone according to one's desires to have him. So, there is an analogy given that how boons of demigods are like bubbles in the cosmic oceans, which are temporary and they cannot last forever. In next shloka, Krishna describes how he has developed four varnas so that a person can systematically develop into Krishna consciousness along with doing their prescribed duties. It is also in the purport explained how the three modes of material nature governs each of these four varnas, like Brahmana in the mode of goodness, and Kshatriyas in mode of passion, Vaishyas mixed mode of passion and ignorance, and Shudras in mode of ignorance. So there is another fifth category which is defined as Vaishnavas, which is above all Brahmanas because they know the transcendental knowledge of worshipping Supreme Personality of Godhead. Yeah, so In the next shloka, Krishna explains that how he is above all this system which is made by him, and he is aloof from all those material actions and reactions. So there are two analogy given to explain this point, that when a king makes a law for his state, those laws are for the subjects of that state and does not apply to king himself. And then there is another analogy given, that Krishna is the ultimate cause but not the immediate cause. So the rains are the responsible for different types of vegetation that appear on the earth, although without such rains there is no such vegetation growth possible. So this is explained in 4.14. So in next section, Krishna explains about the actions and inactions. So how to get free from bonds of karma, like by being situated in transcendental knowledge, one becomes free from karmic reactions. So there are three activities which are defined: karma, akarma, and vikarma. Karma is activities done which are done with attachment according to shastra, but it can result in reactions, good or bad reactions. Akarma is our activities done with the desire of gaining Krishna consciousness, and these results in transcendental happiness. So we don't get any action or reaction out of that. Vikarmas are done which are against the shastric principles. So we are bound to get bad reactions from doing this vikarma. And lastly, there are two analogies given. In 4.21, where it is defined that how much a person should work and how he should give up proprietorship over his possessions. So it is given that he should work towards only basic necessities. Like, for example, as a machine part requires oiling and maintenance, oiling and cleaning for maintenance, so Krishna consciousness person should only work enough so that he remain fit for doing action in this transcendental service to Krishna. Okay, and the last analogy in 4.24, it's given that how a person who is materially absorbed in this material world, so how he can be liberated. So the answer is Krishna consciousness itself. So the analogy is that a patient who is suffering from stomach disorders due to overindulgence of milk products, it can be cured by another milk product which is curd. So in conclusion, we can for these 12 shlokas is that one should do his duties fixed in the transcendental plane, and receive this which knowledge is received through disciplic succession, and it destroys the reactions of all work one is doing. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Very nice presentation. I especially like this slide. Although very simple, but very profound way they have, you know, nicely defined this karma, akarma, and vikarma. And also, it was too succinct. I was hoping he will go on for at least 10-15 good minutes, but he just very speedily covered up the whole. So, we are on text 11. Please repeat once again. Ye yatha mam prapadyante, tam sthaiva bhajami aham, mama vartma anuvartante, manushyaha partha sarvashaha. So this needs the knowledge of two things. It needs the knowledge of yoga ladder, how Krishna has arranged for everyone to get fulfilled their desires. And the second thing we need to know is Krishna's reciprocations with each of the living beings in this material world. How does he deal with them? So Krishna has given the hierarchy of consciousness in the yoga ladder. So the lowest level is animals, then karmakand. We have studied this multiple times, so I'll not get into detail. Then there is karma yoga, jnana yoga, ashtanga yoga, bhakti yoga, like that. And then accordingly, attitudes and behaviors that people have, likes and dislikes that they show, attachment degrees that they have towards matter. So this is the yoga ladder. So mama vartma refers to this one singular path which is either leading towards transcendence or away from transcendence. It's wrong to think that you follow any path you'll go to God. No, it needs to have the ascending mode of that path. Okay, you situate yourself in the yoga ladder and you're looking upward to go towards transcendence. Then mama vartma anuvartante manushyaha partha sarvashaha. That's true. But if somebody is on the ladder but is trying to get down, that is not going towards Krishna. So therefore, yato mat tato path doesn't apply. What applies is hierarchical elevation, gradual elevation given through the yoga ladder towards Krishna. That works. So one has to situate oneself according to one's level of consciousness in the yoga ladder. So for all of us, Arjuna is a sample, prototype devotee. And Krishna to Arjuna, he is telling him, you are capable of doing Nishkam Karma Yoga. And while practicing Nishkam Karma Yoga, I want you to be a Bhakti Yogi. Right? So that's the mood overall. Be dutiful, be detached, be devoted to Krishna. So that's the generic path that is prescribed for all of us. Those who are neither too attached nor too detached. Bhakti Yogo Asya Siddhidaha. For them, Bhakti Yoga is best with this arrangement. Now we look at how Krishna deals with all these people in this yoga ladder. So think of people who are already devotees. So with them, we know there are five rasas and Krishna is personally involved. End to end, he cares for his devotees. You know, he says, Kaunteya Pratijanihi, Name Bhaktaha Pranashyati. Nothing will go wrong with them. Why? Because they are so dedicated to Krishna. So then below there are these Ashtanga Yogis. You know, Prabhupada says in the purport that they want powers like God. You know, the Ashta Siddhis. But they don't want to sometimes necessarily want to have a relationship with God. So God keeps them in Shantaras. So here are the powers and here is Shantarasa. Keep quiet. Okay. Be yourself. So that is his reciprocation with the Ashtanga Yogis. Of course, some Ashtanga Yogis do become Bhakti Yogis eventually. Then there is Jnana Yogis. They want the Chit feature of God, where, you know, they want to become like fully knowledgeable, cognizant of everything in the creation. To them, Krishna says, okay, here are scriptures. Here is your mind. Go on speculating. Waste your time, in short. So these nannies, typically. Jnana Yogis, they want to get connected to Krishna. So Krishna arranges Bahunam, Janmanam, Ante, Jnanavan, you know, Maam Prapadyate. After studying so much, living the life of Jnana Yogi, as described in 13.8 of Bhagavad Gita, they become devotees eventually. So then there are Karma Yogis. So with Karma Yogis, Krishna says they like work, action in the material field. So Krishna says, here is Varanashram system. Okay, follow this Varanashram, situate yourself appropriately, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. That will come in the next verse. And elevate your consciousness, come back to me. So that is for Karma Yogis. How to utilize Varanashrama? That harnesses your modes to help you transcend the modes. Kaate se kaata nikalna. So that is what Varanashrama typically does. So this is Krishna's reciprocation with them, those who want Karma Marga. Then below this, there are Sakam people. They don't want yoga. They just want Sakam Karma. So for them, Krishna, he arranges the demigods. You know, the shopkeepers in the mall, Brahmanda Mall. And they supply, you know, varieties of ingredients. And these people, because they are attracted to a particular commodity too much, they go to them and they think that they are my sarve sarva. You know, they are be all end all of my life. You know, they provide me this. And in this way, indirectly through the devatas, Krishna supplies them their requirements. This is his reciprocation actually, because that is their level of surrender. So Krishna is reciprocating, but through this means. Then below this are people who are like animals, Vipada Pashu. They neither practice Vedas, nor do they take shelter of any higher authority. They just want sense gratification anyhow. So for them, Krishna says, okay, that's little tough now because you can't enjoy matter. You are spirit. But let's try and figure out how to make you enjoy matter. So Krishna says that he creates this varieties of coverings of ignorance, avidya of various kinds, and then he allows the jiva first to forget his swarupa, then to identify with new some concocted role, goal, responsibility, then he allows him to get attached to something and averse to something, and then he creates this mental concoction that this is enjoyable and that is not enjoyable. So in this way, materialistic people are actually getting to enjoy matter in illusion, because Krishna is reflecting tiny bit of his potency, his reciprocation through matter to them. I will ask you this question. Is Gulab Jamun is what we enjoy? Because the juice of the Gulab Jamun is material and the tongue is material. When they come in contact with each other, there is no bhava, okay? That it doesn't get produced like that. There is no rasa there, okay? What is happening is the jiva's perverted senses, spiritual senses, are given a tiny outlet. Krishna says, rasoham, I am the taste in everything tasty. Huh? So it's Krishna's perverted, minuscule, and so to say, separated energy that is manifesting some reflectional taste. And that is what this jiva, who is a materialist, is enjoying. And he finds that as ecstasy. You know, you can imagine. I'm not giving worse examples like liquor and that way. Just Gulab Jamun. So, people find this kind of things enjoyable because it is Krishna who is giving them a glimpse of what is rasa in a perverted form through Gulab Jamun. And in this way, he is also reciprocating with them. They cannot live without Krishna. You know, they cannot live without sunshine, moonshine, water, grains, and all these are nothing but Krishna's manifestations in this creation. So in this way, Krishna is reciprocating with them, but really like a third party, you know, just not involved at all much. And they are also aloof from this whole concept of Krishna consciousness. And in this way, ye yatha mam prapadyante tam stathaiva bhajami aham. So hearing this, what should be the conclusion? What should be the conclusion?
We should take out of the covers of
ignorance. Okay, how do we do that?
By service.
By service. So we have to improve the quality of our reciprocation with Krishna. Currently, we are treating Krishna sometimes as an order supplier, sometimes as a, you know, I want knowledge, I want siddhi, I want whatever, you know, bhukti mukti siddhi kami, sakale ashanta. And thus we are very frustrated actually. Instead, we have to turn towards Krishna and tell him that I do not seek any of these things from you. I only want a relationship with you that I want to share. So this is the beginning of our surrender. You know, and this happens at the time of Diksha. Diksha kale bhakta kare atma samarpan. Tar kale Krishna tare kare atma sam. So at the time of initiation, we take this vow. We generally tend to think, okay, 16 rounds, 4 regs. Okay, after that, my life is my life. You know, that kind of a thing, you know. But actually, Diksha means full self-surrender, which means no separate interests, following strictly Guru's instructions, really trying to develop one's relationship with Krishna. And this is the goal of this process of initiation. And this chance is given to all of us in ISKCON that we can actually begin this process. And we can see from the time of Diksha onwards, Krishna actually orchestrates the life of the devotee in such a way that he can come more and more closer to him. So this is Mama Vartma, Krishna's path, huh? The Krishna path. Achha. I don't like the word race somehow. This is not some race. But yeah, it rhymes, so it's very nice. From your place, at your pace, join the chase after Krishna. Movement. Okay. And in this way, accordingly get my grace. So this is the 11th verse. And this is how Prabhupada concludes it. He says, okay, forget. Somebody may say, but I'm not pure. And I don't know whether Krishna will reciprocate with a guy like this. Prabhupada says, akama sarva kamova in the purport. Moksha kama udaradhi. Tivrena bhakti yoge na yajeta purusham param. He says, forget who you are, what nonsense background you carry. Whatever background, tivrena bhakti yogena. Wholehearted, intense devotional service. Yajeta purusham param. Because Krishna is champion of reciprocation. And he exactly knows how to award these attempts. 12th verse. Kangshantam karmanam siddhim yajanta iha devataha. Kshipram hi manushe loke siddhir bhavati karmaja. Please read translations.
Men in this world desire success in productive activities, and therefore they worship the demigods. Quickly, of course, men get results from productive work in this world.
So in the purport, some 15-20th line says the whole conclusion. The intelligent person in Krishna, is in Krishna consciousness, and he has no need to worship the paltry demigods for some immediate temporary benefit. Bas. That's the conclusion of this verse. And the word paltry is like a heavy word. Huh? Just today we were studying the structure of the Brahmanda and where are the devatas situated and how they, in the Bhagavatam 5th canto. My God, they're really, you know, we are super paltry in front of them, but they are no less paltry, you know. They're really insignificant in comparison to the entire arrangement done by the Lord in providing the necessities of the jivas in this Brahmanda. So that line is the crux of this whole verse. So why is Krishna saying Kangshantam Karmanam Siddhim? Everyone is desiring perfection of their own particular fruitive activity. You know? So somebody is trying to build some empire. There is just recently some book got released. I was talking about it to one devotees. How this world has become self-centered. It's called me, myself and I. That's all. Though everything gets over there. You know? So the whole selfie, you know, culture has gone to an extent where ego becomes so, we are told that there is this perfect being, you know, okay, perfected self. He is rich, famous, slim, beautiful, has great political, whatever kind of influence, and has enormous control over surroundings. And movies and everything is full of this kind of, you know, the perfect being idea. Everyone in the civilization is running after that image. You know, how will I become like this? And this is depressing. This is the reason why people commit suicide and undergo depression in their life. So, what we should do is, this world is designed for fruitive activity. So if you do a little fruitive activity, you get reciprocation from the world of matter. It provides you something in return. So kshipram. Kshipram hi manushe loke siddhir bhavati karmaja. Very quickly, for little karma that you do, you get some results in this world. But there is a problem. What is the problem? This kshipram, quick results, actually makes us forget the real purpose of coming in this world, which is to go back to Godhead. So people get caught up in this. Oh, I tried that job and I got this much, you know. And then maybe I should try this one now and then I'll get that much. And then after that I will do this and then I'll get. So in this way, that kshipram thing keeps them completely entangled. They don't consider at any point of time, why do I need it in first place? So much of fruitive results in return for all the work that I do. And this is why siddhir bhavati karmaja. The karmaja, living beings that are, so to say, born of fruitive activity, to perform fruitive activity, get quick results of that fruitive activity. That's the description here. But the problem is, just like we say this, that, you know, rats, they want to enjoy Govinda's, you know, vada pav or whatever at night, you know, they come around. So for them, the arrangement is such that if they can figure out certain mechanisms, actually every single day they fetch their particular type of enjoyment. Similarly, in the Brahmanda, the fruitive results are kept in such a manner that we think that I'm struggling so hard, you know, but usually they are kept, you know, according to your own desires and karma. And you put a little effort somewhere, you get something from some other source. And you think, wow, this is working, this is happiness in life. So the purpose of this verse is to turn our consciousness away from this mentality, Kshipram mentality, that I want quick results for all the fruity work that I am putting. And how can we turn that around? We have to really study this Bhagavatam's description of the structure of the Brahmanda, the position of the Devatas, and the whole cosmic arrangement that is done simply to get us liberated from this material world. That's why even Parikshit Maharaj, although he's on his way to death, he's spending so much time hearing this description in the Srimad Bhagavatam. It really helps us broaden our perspective, look at our geography, where we are located, our history, where we come from, and our purpose, where we are to go. It becomes very clear after studying Vedic cosmology. So that topic we will handle some other time. What is Vedic cosmology? But it will suffice to say that there is no need of serving any big guns, Prabhupada says, last 10 lines. All of them, therefore, kowtowing to the so-called leaders or big guns in order to achieve temporary boons. And they indeed achieve such things. Such foolish men are not interested in Krishna consciousness for the permanent solution to the hardship of material existence. They are all after sense enjoyment, and to get a little facility for sense enjoyment, they are attracted to worshipping empowered living entities known as demigods. This verse indicates that people are rarely interested in Krishna consciousness. They are mostly interested in material enjoyment. Therefore, they worship some powerful living entity. So in modern times, the demigods have become replaced by actors, actresses, the corporation owners, you know, the sports persons. These are the demigods of modern time. And people are running after them to get some enjoyment, you know, for themselves. Okay, so the first verse talked about the need of building personal relationship with Krishna. The second talk, 12th, I mean to say, second means 12th, talked about no need to build relationship with demigods. And now we are to learn, but I am materially attached. How do you tell me to build this relationship with Krishna? So this is the verse. Chaturvarnyam maya srishtam gunakarma vibhagashah tasya kartaram apimam vidhyakartaram avyayam. So we are trying to devise a separate course on this called Varnashrama course, so that we want to train all of our congregation properly in the full picture of it. Sometimes we have heard some things here, something there, and we think we understood now. This verse onwards, the discussion begins with, okay, there is position of Krishna which I need to understand thoroughly to liberate myself from this world. Krishna wants me to build my relationship with him, not with anyone else, any other powerful being in this creation, and for that he wants me to act in this material world in Krishna consciousness. So the clues for this type of action in Krishna consciousness are from this verse onwards. That's why we have named that whole section as how to act on the basis of transcendental knowledge, applying transcendental knowledge to our work in this material world. So in this verse there are few clues. Number one is we have to find our guna and karma, qualities and activities. Qualities give rise to our implicit drives that make us passionate about something. And karma are external activities that make us happy when we perform them. So it's called guna and karma. So some is implicit, another is explicit. So it's called passion and capacity or talent. So guna karma. So we have to find this out, guna karma and vibhagashaha. Accordingly, we have to categorize ourselves into brahmana, kshatriya, vaishya or shudra. In general, kalau shudra sambhavaha. 99.99% population is shudras in Kali Yuga. So it's not very difficult to find that out. So, but in shudras, there are brahminical shudras, you know. There are kshatriya shudras and vaishya shudras, shudra shudras. Okay, so that is also. So in this way, Krishna says, maya srishtam. I created this system. What is the meaning of maya srishtam? Two meanings. This is an eternal system. It's a God-given system which is perfect. And in every civilization, no matter what time, place, circumstance, there is a version of this always available. You can see it. Just like in modern corporate companies, there is a bunch of people doing fundamental research, brahminical type, it's brahmana shudra. Then there is the people who are doing administration, hire and fire people, you know, organize things. So they're like kshatriyas. And they're constantly competing and expanding and wanting to protect their own status quo. Then there are those who are vaishyas, finance and marketing and all those businesses. And then there are shudras, they're just ordinary laborer, produce some, you know, whatever they are asked to produce, you know. So in this way, maya srishtam, the system is always existing in spite of varieties of changes in time, place, circumstance. So Krishna says, tasya kartaram, I am all the maker of this system, vidhi akartaram. But I am not entangled or bound into that system. I am above that system. Because I am avyayam. I am not changeable. My position always remains as it is. The jiva undergoes this change in consciousness, changing positions, changing things, changing bodies. But I am avyaya. And in this way, by fixing our consciousness on Krishna, and acting for work in Varnashram system, we also become like Krishna eventually. We attain our spiritual position. So vidhi akartaram avyayam. Another importance of this is that we should figure this out for ourselves, who am I, and act accordingly. And also help others around us, whoever are our dependents or cohorts, team members, to figure this out and work accordingly. To make them truly happy in material and spiritual life. So how do we do that? How do we know which varna I am? Which ashrama should I belong to? So there are three clues generally. Number one clue is through astrology. It clearly tells you are a brahmana varna, kshatriya varna, vaishya varna. For that, best is to not have a cesarean birth. Because natural birth is according to the arrangements in the nature. Caesarean changes the timing a little. Some error occurs in calculating. Another is, of course, to get the qualified astrologers. The second way to learn this is through teachers and peers that we have who can tell us about our nature, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats. And finally, also through our own self-introspection and observation. Where do I flourish? Where do I perish? So we have to figure this out and do accordingly. So this is first application of transcendental knowledge. Situate yourself in Varnashrama. While situating there, still fix your consciousness on Krishna, who is Avyaya. Now, Krishna further explains this Avyaya. Why he is not disturbed by the systems that he creates. Generally, when we create something, we get entangled and we are affected by it. But why is Krishna not affected? So that is 14-15 onwards.
Namam karmani limpanti name karma phale spruha iti mam yo bhijanati karma bhirna sabadhyate.
Translation.
There is no work that affects me, nor do I aspire for the fruits of action. One understands this truth about me, also does not become entangled in the full reaction of joy.
Prabhupada gives the analogy, the proprietor of a big establishment never desires the low class enjoyments that the workers in that establishment are enjoying. You have seen this? So in the same way, Krishna creates such a big empire, big establishment, and there are fruitive workers. They are just enjoying something paltry. And the owner of that establishment, he is not at all interested in this kind of foolish activities. Generally, you don't see them eating gutkha, spitting around, or you know, that kind of. They have their own stature in how they enjoy their life. So namam karmani limpanti, we explained that. Then comes name karma phale spruha. I don't want to enjoy the fruits of work. Why is that so? Because material enjoyment is not real enjoyment. It is illusion or mirage of enjoyment. So name karma phale spruha. Just like if somebody creates a video game where people are entangled in playing it. But generally the game maker, he knows that if you do that action, you get that result, and you do that action, you get that result. And I don't want to get into this business inside that video game. I have other things to do in my life. That's just for some giving fun to those guys who want to enjoy that type of thing. So name karma phale spruha. Then comes itimam yo abhijanati, one who knows me like this, karma bhirna sabadhyate. So he is not bound by law of karma. Prabhupada writes the last few lines in the purport. 5 lines. One who does not know the transcendental nature of the Lord and who thinks that the activities of the Lord are aimed at fruitive results, as are the activities of ordinary living entities, certainly becomes entangled himself in fruitive reactions. But one who knows the supreme truth is liberated, is a liberated soul. But one who knows the supreme truth is a liberated soul fixed in Krishna consciousness. So, in the analogy of the proprietor, I forgot to mention one thing in the purport. The proprietor of the establishment is not responsible for the right and wrong activities of the workers. Nor is he interested in the low-class enjoyments that they are having. So, 2 points in that same analogy. So, Lord creates and remains aloof from this creation, whereas the living entities are entangled in it. It's something like the spider, you know, makes the web, and he is transcendental. He is not attached into that web getting stuck up. But some foolish, whatever type of creatures come, getting attracted to the glitter, get caught inside. Text 15. Now, evam jnatva. Knowing this means I am above karma. Evam jnatva. Evam jnatva krutam karma purvairapi mumukshubhihi kuru karmaiva tasmatvam purvai purvataram krutam. Translation. So we see that Krishna is calling for an action, it's a call for an action, but he also quotes authority. Purvai purvataram krutam. Those liberated souls, the way they have acted in the past, similarly you should also act following in their footsteps. Why? So they were mumukshubhi. They exactly knew how to disentangle themselves from this web of Maya. That's why you should follow in their footsteps. Purvai rapi mumukshubhi. So in the middle of the purport, foolish persons or neophytes in Krishna consciousness often want to retire from activities without having knowledge of Krishna consciousness. Arjuna's desire to retire from activities on the battlefield was not approved by the Lord. One need only know how to act. To retire from the activities in Krishna consciousness and to sit aloof making a show of Krishna consciousness is less important than actually engaging in the field of activities for the sake of Krishna. And Rupa showed this, you know, by his own example throughout his life. Like when Mayapur Prabhupada was taking the devotees around and he was pointing, okay, here we will have a big prasadam hall, there we should have a temple, and here we should have old brahmachari, old devotees ashram. And they, you know, get worn out, the body is not working so much, they are old now, they can't do service. They should come here and stay and simply chant, take prasadam and rest. Nothing else to do. So devotees looked at Prabhupada and says, what is your definition of old? Oh, Prabhupada Divijeti says, as far as I am concerned, I don't think I am old. I would rather prefer dying on the battlefield than coming and sitting here. So we see this, that Prabhupada all chance if he wanted to retire from kon itna magaj mari, you know, karega duniya ke saath. Just be yourself, chant, you know, be happy, take prasadam. It's not a big deal in life. But Prabhupada really went out of his way. That's why he writes this. This is far superior to be actually engaging in the field of activities for the sake of Krishna. And Prabhupada had to tolerate all kinds of things. We went to Africa and there are these... There are those people from Africa. They attended the class and Prabhupada was seeing that in the morning when he went for seeing his clothes, they were not there. So when he came for giving the class, he saw one person was wearing kurta, another was wearing dhoti. You know? And Prabhupada said, well, you can't take away spiritual master's clothes. One of the regulative principles to be told. And then some of them, they were eating flies. Just catch one and eat. And Prabhupada said, fifth regulative principle is no eating flies. Though you can imagine preaching in such places, who will take so much headache? You know? But this is what we mean by actually engaging in the field of activities for the sake of Krishna. Who are these Purvai Purvataram Mumukshu? So Prabhupada explains that. Therefore, he recommends the acts of the sun god who learned the art from the Lord some millions of years before. So Vivasvan is being quoted according to Prabhupada. All such students of Lord Krishna, okay, interesting log rahe, you know, are mentioned here as past liberated persons engaged in the discharge of duties allotted by Krishna. And this is where all these other devatas that are pure devotees, like Vivasvan in our Brahmanda is a pure devotee. Yamaraja, Dharmaraja, he's a pure devotee. Ganapati of our Brahmanda is a pure devotee. Our Brahma is a pure devotee. They are acting in the field of material life. Okay? They are doing a lot of work for others. But they are not getting entangled. Especially Yamaraj. You can imagine his duty, you know. Passing judgment on others, the worst thing you can... Judge ye not, lest ye shall be judged. You know? So we know what is the effect of trying to judge somebody else. And he's sitting and doing that as a 24/7 business. Whoever comes in front of judgment. You know? So imagine what kind of karma somebody can accumulate if he was a slightly deviating from Krishna consciousness in that moment. But Yamaraj never accrues karma. He is always free from it. That is a proof of power of Krishna consciousness, how it keeps one immune to the reactions of work. So, practical. Some of us should get into politics. Some of us should get into administration, governance of education. Others should get into minting money and fully donating it to Krishna. Others should get into, you know, producing value in the society through the labor that they have in such a way that gradually people's consciousness can be turned towards Krishna. And in this way, we'll not get affected if we remain properly Krishna conscious. In God We Trust was the name of the political party formed by Prabhupada. And he gave this instruction to this Amarendra Prabhu, who was the TP of Amsterdam, if I'm not wrong. So, so they started this political party, In God We Trust. That is the name of the political party. Okay, he stood for election. And in the Fatwa, agenda, manifesto, you know, agenda for the election, he said, if we come on the power,
No meat eating, no gambling, no illicit sex, no intoxication. Directly declared, you know. And they lost. They obviously lost the election. No, and they got 300 votes. And they became very sad, you know. They went to Prabhupada and said, Prabhupada, we did so much effort, only 300. Prabhupada said, find out who these 300 people are. They are fit candidates for becoming devotees. If they gave vote for this agenda, they are surely devotees. So you can think of it, what all things have happened, you know, in our Hare Krishna movement. No? It's quite a bit of a movement. Huh? Yes. Our Ganapati is pure devotee. How do we claim that? See, Vyasadev, he hired Ganapati for this writing Vedas, compiling Vedas in written form. Hired is a very bad term. He requested. And he agreed. There was no pay given, okay, for that. So Vyasadev had a condition while writing. So all this Bhagavatam and everything is written by him. Okay. You cannot write unless you realize it. So from that condition we know that he is a pure devotee. Usually demigods are karma mishrita bhaktas and higher planets mahar tapar tapaloka, they are jnana mishrita yoga mishrita bhaktas.
So they also follow the yoga ladder.
Yeah, the hole is a yoga ladder. Up in the Brahmanda also there is a yoga ladder. You know, those who are totally away from Krishna consciousness, they go atala, vitala, sutala, talatala, bilaswarga. High class material life without Krishna. So that is how yoga ladder is actual ladder also. There are people situated, you know, on a physical level in the Brahmanda there. Based on that. Our Ganapati is in Kailas, abode of Lord Shiva, which happens to be in the Jambudvipa. It's one of the borders of Jambudvipa. Oh, sorry. Our Kailasa is our Kailasa. Not, that is another Kailasa. So our Kailasa is the Himalaya, and that Himalaya has got the Kailasa on one side and Badrika Ashram in the middle somewhere and Kubera's abode in another. So that is our border of Bharatavarsha, or Bharatakhanda. You want to go meet him? Asking. I was wondering. We should like to meet.
I was wondering about the devotees, because there is a lot of thing about Agyat Sukriti.
Yeah. Every time I see Ganapati, I only pray one thing. I want to someday write books on spiritual life and education. You know, please empower me to do that. So you can ask things. No problem. You should ask, I'm saying.
No, I ask for a different way. I ask for removing all obstacles in my...
To devotion, yeah, correct. Devotion. Wonderful.
So that is better
than best. Than writing books. I'm still a sakam, whatever. Okay. So we go to 16. Sweet 16. Kim karma kim akarmeti kavayopyatra mohitaha. Tatte karma pravakshami yajnyatva mokshase ashubhat. Translation.
Even the intelligent are bewildered in determining what is action and what is inaction. Now I shall explain to you what action is, knowing which you shall be liberated from all misfortune.
Kavayopi atra mohitaha. Even intelligent are bewildered in deciding how to act and how not to act in this most entangling material world. So the clue, act by getting guidance from superior authority. So that's the theme in the whole purport. This is second paragraph, last line. Because of the direct instruction of Lord to Arjuna, anyone who follows in the footsteps of Arjuna is certainly not bewildered. Dharmam tu sakshat bhagavat pranitam. No one can manufacture a religious principle by imperfect speculation. There are great authorities. There are 12 of them. Mahajanas. Brahma, Shiva, Narada, Manu, Kumara, Kapila, Prahlada, Bhishma, Shukadev, Goswami, Yamaraj, Janak, Bali Maharaj. By mental speculation, we cannot ascertain what is religion or self-realization. Therefore, out of causeless mercy to his devotees, the Lord explains directly to Arjuna. One only action performed in Krishna consciousness can
deliver a person from entanglement of material existence. Nowadays there is so much of this varieties of people wanting to become coaches, mentors, starting their websites on, you know, we will give you wealth, we will give you health, we will get you, you know, some high leadership acumen, you know, you become the whatever. And if you actually go through even the slightest of that content, you can figure out how much mental speculation, how much of, you know, wanting to give sub-religious principles at max, some morality to people. No discussion whatsoever about you become a leader when you become a true follower of a perfect leader. Who is a true follower of a perfect leader? Like that you go to Krishna, the perfect leader of everybody. That is never mentioned. So we should be very careful not to borrow. Text 17. Karmano yapi bodhavyam, bodhavyam cha vikarmanaha, akarmanascha bodhavyam gahana karmano gatihi. Translation? So the word gahana karmano gatihi, intricacies of karma are very hard to understand. So this word karma is used in many contexts. One is action, plain. Another is law of action and reaction. Another is prescribed duty. So there are various connotations. Also another meaning, action that ensures that you will get another body. It's called karma. So there are various definitions. So here this karmano gatihi refers to the law of karma. Okay, the intricacies of action are very hard to understand. And we see this in the stories of Dhritarashtra when he was asking Krishna, why did my sons die? And you know, so many places people ask that question. Hamare saath aisa bura kyun hua? Because no intelligent person, however intelligent he is, kavayopi atra mohitaha, he cannot understand these subtleties. So Prabhupada says in the purport, the entire Bhagavad Gita is directed towards action in Krishna consciousness. Any other conclusion against this consciousness and its attendant action are vikarmas. Hare Krishna. Even so-called pious activities are vikarma. Why? Because they take you away from Krishna. So that's the mood. To understand all this, one has to associate with authorities, learn the secret. Otherwise, even most intelligent persons will be bewildered. So in this, what is the mood and mission that Prabhupada is putting forth by saying that any action other than Krishna consciousness is vikarma? What's the... Yes, correct. Krishna is the only hope. Especially in Kali Yuga, don't waste time with other things. What else? Following the authorities. Yes. To become Krishna conscious. There is one interesting mood here. I am wanting you to catch it. Yes. He wants. Eternal? We are eternal servitors of Krishna. There is nothing else we can do as best occupation in life. Okay, you have to like things that Krishna wants you to do, and you should want to do things that Krishna likes you to do. Something like that. Make your will Krishna's will. Okay. Okay. Act to bring others also to Krishna, not just yourself. Because they will otherwise get into karma or vikarma. Preach. The one thing I was looking for is the sense of how anya bhilashita shunyam jnana karma adi anavrutam anukulena krishna anushilanam bhakti ruttama. So that mood is that anything that falls a little short of pure devotion to Krishna is a contamination. It's something that is not up to the mark. It's like that Raghav Pandit's cleanliness phobia, you know. Somebody touched the ceiling and touched the coconut to be offered to the deity. He said, throw it away. It cannot be offered. Why? Because you touched the dust, you know. You know the story, right? Raghav Pandit's story. So similarly, this is the mood. Prabhupada's mood is similar in this context. One time, our Giriraj Maharaj, I think, I told this story earlier. He had gone to this some South Indian gentleman and he was wanting to cultivate him to become, convince him to become a life member. He argued and argued and argued with Giriraj Maharaj on how Brahman is superior and Bhagavan is inferior. And he was thorough Mayavadi in discussion. And Giriraj Maharaj, point after point after point, you know, he was establishing superiority of bhakti. And he was wondering in his heart that this person is arguing, and if I'm going on defeating like this, I don't think he'll ever become a member of ISKCON. But should I continue? Because I want him to also do some seva for Prabhupada. And by defeating, I'm defeating that purpose. But anyways, because he was speaking so much Mayavad, he went on talking to him very matter of fact, honest, not angry or anything, but just putting points across. And then that man refused. He said, now you go, Hare Krishna. Nothing, no becoming life member. So then he came back and then he wrote a letter to Prabhupada saying that I went and I had this experience and I'm not very sure whether I did the right thing. Bodhavyam cha vikak, what is that? Gahana karmano gatihi, you know. Kavayopi atra mohitaha. Did I do the right or wrong? So Prabhupada, he had not yet got the letter, but next day that person was supposed to be meeting again, and then he, when he meant to meet him again, that person took him by the hand and took him inside his house for the first time. That was the office, and then he took him to his home, and inside his house he had proper Radha Krishna deities that he was worshipping, and he was a wonderful devotee of the Lord. And he gave him darshan and told him that I'm actually a bhakta, I'm not a Mayavadi. Giriraj Maharaj was shocked. I was testing you yesterday, he said. That whether for getting money and getting this whatever, you know, facility for running some temple, you will compromise your philosophy. And Giriraj Maharaj was thrilled, you know, that, and he immediately gave the check and he became a life member also after that. So Giriraj Maharaj came back running, you know, to the temple. He was waiting for that letter, and that letter had arrived. And he opened the letter and he saw this. Prabhupada says, as far as preaching pure Krishna consciousness and practicing it is concerned, my Guru Maharaj never compromised. I never compromised. And my followers, my disciples also shall never compromise. You know, that was the reply Prabhupada had given. So you did the right thing by telling him the truth. So you see, this whole thing is about how we should be pure in practice and pure in presentation of Krishna consciousness. Of course, some devotees may say, well, if you speak too much, you know, truth, people go away. What about that part? We should not tell them the truth that takes them away from the absolute truth. So what about that part? So tell the truth in a way that brings them closer to the absolute truth, but never not tell the truth. Sometimes you may say, well, that we will discuss soon, after this prasanam or whatever. We will talk about that topic. Let's continue our cultural inculturation. So inculcation. So 18th, karmanya karma yah pashyet akarmani cha karma yah sabuddhiman manushyeshu sayuktaha kritsna karma krit. Translation: See, this is typical language of Upanishads, Gita Upanishad. So Upanishad like this, playing with the words, you know, karmani akarmaha yaha pashyet akarmani cha karma yaha sabuddhiman. Very intelligent manusheshu sayuktaha kritsna karma krit. So we'll give two examples. One is the example of I gave this earlier also, Ultadak and Sultadak.
So there is Sulta duck. He is gliding over the water and is looking very calm, elegant. You know. But if you go below the surface of the water, the feet are in such an agitated condition. Like that. So materialistic people are like that Sulta duck. Externally, they are very calm, cool, composed. You know. And inside, consciousness, it's a lot of uthal-puthal going on. Yeah. And, you know, they don't know what next they are going to do. Suicide or, you know, murder, you know, either of the two. So that is, so. And devotee is a ulta duck. You know, externally he is doing so many activities, going here, going there, preaching, distributing books, this, that, you know. And in the Tomara Rudaye Sada Govinda Vishram Govinda Kahe Namora Vaishnava Paran. So in the heart of the devotee, because Krishna is taking proper rest, and if Krishna can only take rest in a heart that is not restless. So imagine your bed, you know, that is constantly moving like, yeah, to sleep. Difficult. So Krishna is in the heart of that devotee. He is peaceful. You know, apuryamanam achalapratishtam samudram apapravaya sashantim apnoti. He is peaceful inside, in his heart. All his agitations are going on around. But internally he is peaceful. And then, this analogy is to help us see also, Krishna is saying, karmani akarma yahaya paschet. So devotee is acting externally so many varieties of, now fields of action he is handling, but a karma. Why? Nothing is done for any personal sake. Everything is done for Krishna's pleasure, and that's why he is peaceful. And a karmani, somebody's so-called inaction. You know, somebody has gone to Himalayas performing some yoga sadhana, breathing exercise. He appears to be aloof from the society, supposed to be cutting his karma. But there is karma involved there. What is that karma? That there is karma of, first of all, neglecting prescribed duty. If one fails in that yoga practice, he will have to pay for it. You know, it's not like bhakti yoga. Also, there is, you breathe, you have to eat. Even sometimes devotees get excited, I will go become a Radhakund Babaji. And they go and stay for a while. And there they say, my God, Babaji also have to do a lot of management actually. You have to dry your kaupin and it has to be in the same place the next day. You know, otherwise you are in trouble. You know, so it requires some management skills to do that. From that point onwards to exactly be on time for Madhukari at particular location where you get prasadam. So there are many subtleties involved, you know, in sadhu life that are otherwise not known, you know, till you become like that. So one thinks, oh, what is there? I will manage this. No. Even there are subtleties, and one has to act to maintain one's body. Sharira yatra apichate na prasiddhye akarmanaha. Even we cannot maintain our body without action. And this is why there is karma involved in that so-called inaction that is being practiced. So-called sadhu life, so-called yogi. But there is karma involved there. So one who can see like this, sa buddhiman manushyeshu, he is very intelligent. And sa yuktaha, he is now properly situated in his transcendental position. Krutsna karma krut, although he is engaged in all sorts of activities, continuously, one after another. So we have to be wary of two things, mindless action and foolhardiness. Although we are told to act, be constantly in action mode, but it should not be a purposeless and taking risks that are not appropriate. So 19 onwards are clues on how to act in transcendental consciousness. So we just now said sa yuktaha. So how do you become that type of yuktaha? So first is you have to have right perspective, which was told in this verse. What is the perspective? To see action in inaction and inaction in action. Now the next verse talks about having perspective is like darshan, philosophy. Now there is a right attitude or mental setup, and that is in this verse. Yasya sarve samarambha kama sankalpa varjitaha jnanagni dagdha karmanam tamahu panditam buddha. Translation.
One is understood to mean full knowledge, whose every endeavor is devoid of desire for sense gratification. He is said by sages to be worker for whom the reactions of work have been burned up by the fire of perfect knowledge.
So, in the beginning of the work that you are about to take up, any enterprise, first thing you do, kama sankalpa varjitaha. The arambha, samarambha, beginning of any work, you first meditate. I am not going to do this for sense gratification. I am going to do this for Krishna's pleasure. This is the step. This is the mental preparation that you should do before beginning your work. What happens for such a person? Jnana Agni, we are discussing actually Jnana Yoga, so this comes again and again. Jnana Agni Dagdha Karmanam. So the reaction to that work that is going to come is already burnt up by this attitude. Tamahu Panditam Buddha, and he is called a champion action person, you know, in working in this world. So typically we have this prayers that help us to do this. Kayena vacha manasendriyairva buddhyatmana va prakrute svabhavat karomi yadyat sakalam parasmai narayanaya iti samarpaya. Whatever I am going to do with my body, mind, senses, I am going to offer it to Krishna. Or there is prayers like tvadiya vastu govinde tubhyameva samarpaye. Oh Lord, everything belongs to you, I am going to offer it back to you. Or there are prayers like na dhanam na janam na sundarim kavitam va jagadisha. So mama jan, we say these things before beginning the action. This is called kama sankalpa varjitaha, you know, so that's the meaning. Now comes text 20. Tyaktva karma phala sangam nitya trupto nirashrayah karmani abhipravruttopi naiva kinchit karoti saha. Translation. So then comes the action part. What is that action? Tyaktva karma phala sanga. Give up the attachment to the results of your activities. Like, you know, there was this example in the Swaminarayan people. One of their very big, sincere, devoted, you know, person, he worked very hard to build a big project. Some 3000 crore project or something like that. After whole thing got constructed, inauguration happened, the main guru came, there was a big festivity, everything. And the guru told him, now you should go to this London or some other place and start another project there. And that night he left. You know, can you imagine somebody does something like this? How much attached he may become to wanting to enjoy that fruit of action for a while at least, if not for long. Immediate next day he was flown, you know, back, another project. Start another 3000 crore something to work on. So this is called Tyaktva Karma Phala Sangam. Prabhupada, in the beginning days of ISKCON, especially in India, he had hardly any success. Imagine somebody trying to preach from 1922 to 1965. Quite a bit of time that is. One disciple, Prabhakar, Rishi Prabhakar, you know, and most opposition in whatever efforts that were started, including family members, you know. But Prabhupada never gave up his particular preach and print work that was given to him by his guru. So that is called Nitya Trupta, always satisfied. Nirashrayaha, not taking material shelters. Nirashrayaha. So Prabhupada translates that as and independent. When you don't take any material shelters, you are truly independent. You don't get budged by someone favoring or not favoring you. That's the way Prabhupada translates. Nirashrayaha means fully independent. And karmani abhipravruttaha, although constantly engaged in varieties of services, naiva kinchit karoti saha, is not doing anything in that state of consciousness. And Prabhupada writes beautifully how the consciousness should be while acting. Like, you know, we give a class, at the end of the class we ask, oh, how was the class? we cook some bhoga. After offering prasadam, people take prasadam. How was the prasadam? What kind of cook am I? You know, so we do some kirtan after the kirtan. So immediately the fruitive mentality is so strong that we generally go and ask this. You know,
So this question we should ask superiors, not the so to say younger devotees, because for them it's all, you know, Hari Bol, Maharaj, Prabhu, whatever, you know. But we should ask superior, then they will tell exactly that this is good, that could be improved. So that is required. Text 21. Nirashriyata chittatma tyakta sarva parigraha shariram kevalam karma kurvannapnoti kilbisham. Translation.
Such a man of understanding acts with mild and perfectly controlled, gives up all sense of proprietorship over his possessions and acts only for the bare necessities of life. Thus working is not affected by sinful reactions.
In the middle, he works, he moves exactly like a part of a machine. As a machine part requires oiling and cleaning, so Krishna conscious man maintains himself just to remain fit for action. First analogy. The second analogy. Like an animal, he has no proprietorship over even his own body. A cruel proprietor of an animal sometimes kills the animal in his possession, yet the animal does not protest, nor does it have any real independence. You require guts, okay, daring to live this kind of description in life, to be so surrendered to the spiritual master. For maintaining body and soul, he does not require unfair means for accumulating money. Thus, he does not become contaminated by material sins. He is free from all reactions to his action.
Yadrucha labha santushto dvandvatito vimatsaraha samasiddhava siddhaucha krutvapi na nibadhyate.
Translation. So Prabhupada liked this verse very much. Yadrucha labha santushtaha. Be santushta with whatever labha you get by yadrucha. Yadrucha means the will of providence. Something that comes out of his own accord. No? So sometimes you get nice facilities, sometimes you don't get so much. Sometimes you get great opportunities to expand, preaching or serve. Other times you don't get much. Santushtaha. Labha santushtaha. Dvandva atita, Prabhupada says, free from duality, and vimatsaraha, does not envy. Samaha siddhava siddhau, siddhi asiddhi, he is equipoised. Such a person, krutvapi na nibadhyate, is not entangled. I remember the story of the Alvars. Namma Alvar was the incarnation of Lord Sword. Is that how it is? I forget the name. Neela Alvar, Namma Alvar. So there were this team of four devotees and they gathered up together and each of them had some mystic siddhis. One could open any lock, another could walk on water, another could... I don't remember the whole story, but they came together and they decided that we have to make this Sri Ranganath's temple. And they engaged themselves in thievery. They would loot from people who were unfairly accumulating money for personal sense gratification and spend that money in building the temple. Now, I'm not recommending anything, okay? I'm just telling the story. Don't get, you know, too much hyper. So, and this Namma Alvar, another, he would walk before the deity of Ranganath with a sword in hand. And if he found anybody not bowing down before the Lord, he would chop off his head. Okay, so. And then there is another,
Tamal Krishna Maharaj, he was serving Prabhupada in Haridwar, Rishikesh, I think. And Prabhupada had, his health was very bad. He was not getting any hunger. He was gradually dwindling in his health. One day he got up and he said, "I am feeling hungry. You have something?" He said, "What do you want, Prabhupada?" They said, "Can I get some fresh Ganges water to drink?" So the can in hand, he jumped off the window because it was on the bank of Ganga. Straight into the water. You know the speed. Took the water and come up to Prabhupada with, you know, all the water coming off his body. This is water for you. So Prabhupada writes here, he neither begs nor borrows, but he labors honestly as far as in his power. He is satisfied with whatever is obtained by honest labor. He is therefore independent in his livelihood. He does not allow anyone's service to hamper his own service. I like this line very much. However, for the service of the Lord, he can participate in any kind of action without being disturbed by the duality of material world. The duality of the material world is felt in terms of heat, cold, misery, happiness. Devotees above this. And he does not hesitate to act in any way for the satisfaction of Krishna. Okay. So, fund collection is coming close. Janmashtami is up. Some of us like it, some of us don't like it. We do it. Even I sometimes feel, what is this money asking? You know, I will better do other things in life than going around telling somebody to give some money. We have to see that is in action, in action. So we go and do it anyhow. So text 23. Gatasangasya muktasya jnanavasthita chetasaha yajnaya charatah karma samagram praviliyate. Translation.
The work of the man who is unattached to the more subjective nature and who is fully situated in transcendental realms is called entirely.
So, Jnana Yoga's perfection. Jnana Vasthita Chetasaha. He is completely situated in transcendental knowledge about his position, position of the Lord, the interrelationship, and the activities to be performed. So, thus, Yajnaya Acharataha Karma. He acts only for the satisfaction of the Lord. So, Samagram Praviliyate. So, his work merges entirely in the transcendence. So how does it merge? That is explained in the next verse. Krishna spoke about his position. Krishna spoke about action that one can practice in relationship to that understanding. This is jnana that he wants us to practice. Jnana yoga. That connects you with the transcendence.
Brahmarpanam Brahmahavir Brahmagnau Brahmanahutam Brahmaivate Nagantavyam Brahma Karma Samadhina.
Translation.
A person who is fully absorbed in Krishna consciousness is sure to attain his spiritual kingdom because of his full contribution to spiritual activities, in which the consummation is absolute and that which is offered is of the same spiritual nature.
So Arpana means what you offer as contribution in the yajna. Havi refers to the clarified butter. Then there is Agni, the fire of consummation. Actually Vishnu who consumes in the form of the yajna fire. And Hutam means that which is offered in the fire. Basically it is just like in deity worship, the main ingredient is our love for the deity to please their senses. In the yajna, the main ingredient is the consciousness of the mantra reciter to please Lord Vishnu while he makes the offering. You get this? So such a person, Brahma iva tena gantavyam, he goes back home, back to Godhead. Or his activities become thoroughly spiritual. Why? Brahma karma samadhina. Because he has already attained complete absorption in the Supreme. He is not thinking the ingredients are separate from the Supreme. He sees their connection with Brahman. He doesn't see the offering being made as separate from the Supreme. He is not seeing the fire as separate from the Supreme. He's seeing as Supreme. And he's seeing the mantras that are helping him offer the oblations as connected to the Supreme. And in this way, he's completely merged into Supreme. Merged in the sense, absorbed. Like in modern times, they use this term flow experience. What is flow experience? Flow experience means when a person performing an action forgets the distinction between himself, the activity, the ingredients being used, the varieties of sequences being followed, and the value that is produced through that action. He sees no distinction. He is absorbed. So this is called flow experience. And more, all companies are spending tremendous amount of money to find out ways and means to help people develop this flow experience in their work, to mint money, of course, in future, through them, to make them into absorbed donkeys, you know. So this concept is nothing new. You see Mother Yashoda in the spiritual world. She has flow experience. When she is churning butter, cooking for Krishna, whatever she is doing, she is thinking in terms of pleasing Krishna. The ingredients are seen in connection with Krishna. The relationships are seen in connection with Krishna. So in this way, she is already having flow experience. So this is what is being described. So this is from the perspective of Jnana Yogi, because Jnana Yogi is still thinking Brahman as one of the targets of his absorption sometimes. Because Jnana Yogis are more attached to Brahman. Ashtanga yogis are more attached to Paramatma. Bhakti yogis are more attached to Bhagavan, feature of the Lord. So the description comes like that. Brahmarpanam, Brahmahavi, Brahmagnav, Brahmanahutam. So when we sit for japa, we have this similar experience. We have the opportunity to experience samadhi, Brahma karma samadhina. Because our tongue is moving and it is producing this divine sound. And in the fire of our consciousness, we are offering that sound as an ahuti, you know. And that consciousness is blazing, purified. And in this way, we are actually becoming more and more absorbed in Krishna consciousness. So every day we have this opportunity when we do japa to attain samadhi. So last 7-8 lines. Krishna consciousness is the process of converting the illusory consciousness into Brahman, illusory material world or matter into spirit, and our temporary material existence being utilized to gain eternal existence. When the mind is fully absorbed in Krishna consciousness, it is said to be in samadhi. Anything done in that state of consciousness is yajna. In that condition, the contributor, contribution, consumption, performer, leader, and the result, everything becomes one in the absolute. That is the method of Krishna consciousness. That's Prabhupada's special. That is the method of okay, so we pause there. Any comments or questions? Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Gaur Premanande Hari Hari Gaur.